Are you learning about the Laplace transform in your differential equations class? But do you want to do more than just compute Laplace transforms? Indeed, do you want to understand what the Laplace transform is telling you about a function? Finally, do you want to see why the Laplace transform is useful for solving differential equations? If any of these descriptions describes you, then this video series is for you. This is the Laplace transform visually explained. Video number 2, more fundamental examples, including if f of t is sometimes negative. The climax of this video comes at the end when we want to understand the Laplace transform of the cosine of omega t, this blue graph on the left that both oscillates above and below the axis. We want to understand why its Laplace transform on the right first increases before it decreases. So let's start by reviewing the definition of a Laplace transform. It's defined using an improper integral. The Laplace transform of a function little f of t is another function, capital F of s, that is defined to be the improper integral from 0 to infinity of little f of t times e to the negative st dt. When you do this integral, the t's will go away. This quantity depends on s. Now let's review a couple basic qualitative observations we made about capital F of s from video number 1. When little f of t is non-negative for all non-negative t. First of all, being defined by an integral, for any fixed s, the value of capital F of s equals the area under the graph of the product little f of t times e to the negative st for all non-negative t, because the graph of little f of t and also the graph of little f of t times e to the negative st will be above the axis. Second, larger values of s will produce a faster exponential decay in the factor e to the negative st, and therefore a smaller area under the graph, smaller values of capital F of s. In other words, capital F is a decreasing function of s. Here in video number 2, we also want to see what happens when the input function little f of t oscillates between positive and negative values as t increases. For example, we're interested in finding and understanding the Laplace transform of the cosine function. If the graph of little f of t truly oscillates both above and below the axis, you know from calculus that the integral is no longer going to be an area. Instead, it's going to be a signed area between the graph of the product f of t times e to the negative st and the horizontal axis for all non-negative t. It'll be an area below the graph when the graph is above the axis, minus an area above the graph when the graph is below the axis. It's not so clear now whether capital F of s is going to be an increasing or decreasing function, though it probably will always be decreasing once s gets sufficiently large and that exponential decay gets sufficiently fast. Before we get into our examples for this video, let's briefly talk about how the Laplace transform is useful for differential equations. Say we're given a second-order differential equation initial value problem, or IVP, like you see here. Y double prime plus 5y prime plus 6y equals cosine of 2t, where the initial values are y of 0 equals 1, and y prime of 0 equals 2. You start the method by taking the Laplace transform of both sides of the ordinary differential equation. In other words, plug both sides into the Laplace transform operator. In other words, keeping in mind that y is a function of t, you get that the Laplace transform of y double prime plus 5y prime plus 6y equals the Laplace transform of cosine of 2t. This is a pretty typical kind of differential equation. It will therefore be important to know what the Laplace transform of cosine of 2t is. It's also important to know how to simplify the left-hand side. Part of what allows us to simplify the left-hand side is that the Laplace transform is a linear operator. The Laplace transform of this linear combination of y double prime and y prime and y is the corresponding linear combination of the Laplace transforms of these functions. This linearity property will be the main topic of video number 3. For the moment, let's just say that using some more properties of a Laplace transform in relation to derivatives and initial values, we can use the initial value problem to write the left-hand side of this equation in terms of the Laplace transform of just y itself. And then we can algebraically solve for that and ultimately find y as a function of t. Now let's use Mathematica to look at 3 very important examples visually to try to focus on the visual understanding of a Laplace transform. All 3 of these examples involve unspecified parameters, and the last example, example 3, involves a cosine function. It goes both above and below the axis. This function that you see here is called the unit step function with jump discontinuity at t equals a. You can see that when t is less than a, the function output is 0, and when t is greater than or equal to a, the function output is 1. There is a jump discontinuity. In Mathematica, the built-in function unit step of t with a capital U and a capital S represents the unit step function with jump discontinuity at t equals 0. In other words, a is 0, and here's what the graph looks like. If I, for example, replace t with, say, t minus 2, that is just a rightward shift of the original graph to the right by 2 units. And if I replace t with t plus 2, that's a leftward shift by 2 units. Let's now use the definition of the Laplace transform to compute the Laplace transform of ua of t when a is non-negative. By definition, it's the integral from 0 to infinity of ua of t times e to the negative st dt. But remember, ua of t is 0 when t is less than a, and 1 when t is greater than or equal to a. So this integral can be replaced by this one, the integral from a to infinity of just e to the negative st dt. That's a pretty quick calculation with the fundamental theorem of calculus, giving you a final answer of e to the negative a times s over s, again for all non-negative a and when s is positive. Now let's use Mathematica to both check our work symbolically and also visualize what's going on here, trying to understand what this means visually. Laplace transform can compute the Laplace transform of this unit step function of t minus a, that would be with jump discontinuity at t equals a. Mathematica's answer for this looks strange and technically is only right when a is positive. Here's what it looks like. Keep in mind, if a is positive, the unit step of a will be 1 because the plain unit step function here in Mathematica represents jump discontinuity at t equals 0. So if a is positive, this is 1, and negative a will then be negative, and unit step of that will be equal to 0. So this really does equal e to the negative as over s when a is positive. We could also do it this way. We could define the function, that is the unit step function, with jump discontinuity at t equals a here as well. Notice that the answer is a little strange looking. It's written as a piecewise function. In the case where a is less than or equal to 0, it writes the answer as 1 over s. Now keep in mind that the integral that defines the function is an integral from 0 to infinity. So when a is negative, this function will actually also equal the constant function 1. And the answer when we take the Laplace transform of the constant function 1 is 1 over s. Here is the main one that we're interested in, e to the negative as over s. We can also check our answer symbolically in a couple other ways. We can do an indefinite integral to check the antiderivative right there. We can also do a definite integral. Mathematica does tell us, warn us, that the real part of s needs to be positive, but of course that will be true if s itself is positive. And now we're on to the animation. This is the same kind of animation that I showed you in video 1. We've got three graphs here. The graph on the left includes two functions. The blue graph is the graph of u sub a of t, in this case a is set to 0.15, and the purple graph is the graph of e to the negative st for some particular value of s, in this case s equals 0.65. This graph right here in pink is the product of the blue and the purple graph, the product of the unit step function and this exponential decay function. Its area is labeled 1.40. This is the function that gets integrated from 0 to infinity to give us the value of the Laplace transform, capital F of s, which is e to the negative a times s over s, when, again, s is 0.65. So you see this area is 1.4. You see when s is 0.65, the value of the Laplace transform is 1.40. As a increases from the value of 0.15 to larger and larger values, you can see that the jump discontinuity for the blue graph on the left keeps moving further and further to the right. That also means the jump discontinuity for the Laplace transform integrand, the function that gets integrated to find the Laplace transform in the middle, moves further and further to the right, making the area under it from a to infinity get smaller and smaller. And then we also see the value of the Laplace transform here now when a is 0.65 is that smaller number, 1.01, which matches this area here. Let's go back now to setting a equal to 0.15 again and letting s increase instead of a. As s increases, the exponential decay factor, the purple graph, goes down faster and faster. That makes the pink graph have a smaller and smaller area, and therefore the Laplace transform has a smaller and smaller value. Here you can see that when s is 3.14, the value of the Laplace transform is 0.2. S increasing further and further makes that black dot on the right go down further and further. The Laplace transform is a decreasing function of s. And the larger a is, the faster the Laplace transform decreases. For our second example, we consider a family of exponential functions. F sub a of t equals a to the at. This is really important for differential equations because exponential functions show up all the time. The Laplace transform of e to the at can be found by definition as this integral, which by properties of exponents is this integral, and doing that integral gives you 1 over s minus a for s greater than a. Note here that a can take on any value whatsoever. We can now check and visualize our answer in the same way as before. The Laplace transform function gives us the answer, 1 over s minus a. We can confirm our antiderivative with an indefinite integral. We can also confirm the actual Laplace transform answer with an improper definite integral. Mathematica warns us that the real part of s needs to be bigger than the real part of a. That will certainly be the case when s is real and bigger than a. That's when this improper integral will converge. Now we can look at the animation of the graphs. Same kinds of interpretations as before. The blue graph over here is the graph of e to the at. Here a is 0.15. The purple graph is the graph of e to the negative st. Here s is 0.41. The product of blue and purple gives you this pink graph, this brown function. The area of 3.85 is the value of the Laplace transform when a is 0.15 and when s is 0.41. In this case, its value is 3.85, which again matches this area. We can again see what happens as a increases. As a increases, that blue graph grows faster and faster, making the area under this pink graph larger and larger, making the value of the Laplace transform larger and larger at that given value of s. I could also increase s and make the exponential decay of the purple graph faster and faster, making the area under the pink graph smaller and smaller, making the value of the Laplace transform smaller and smaller. It is a decreasing function of s. We end with our most interesting example that goes both positive and negative, a family of cosine functions. F sub omega of t is cosine of omega times t. Computing the Laplace transform of cosine of omega t by hand using the definition is a pretty big pain. Technically speaking, you have to use integration by parts a couple times. You'll get this antiderivative, and this, when s is positive, does go to 0 as t goes to infinity. So in the end, you get 0 minus negative s over s squared plus omega squared, which simplifies to s over s squared plus omega squared when s is positive. Note that something new here is happening. This is no longer a decreasing function of s. It will increase at first before it decreases. Once again, we check this in the usual ways, and we visualize it in the usual way, and we'll try to understand why this function increases before it decreases. Notice with the improper integral here that I had to pick omega to be something specific so that Mathematica would rapidly produce an answer. It took too long when I used a general omega. Let's go ahead and look at the animation now. Here we once again see the original function in blue. Again, this time it oscillates both above and below the axis. The purple graph is e to the negative st. The pink graph is the Laplace transform integrand function. When we integrate this function from 0 to infinity, we get the value of the Laplace transform. Here, when s is 0.17, the value of the Laplace transform is 0.27. It's not the area under the graph, it is the signed area between the graph and the horizontal axis. When the graph is above the axis, the area between the graph and the axis is counted as positive. When the graph is below the axis, the area is counted as negative. Positive contributions and negative contributions to the integral, and therefore the Laplace transform. How does the value of omega affect things? Here omega is set to 0.77. If I increase omega, that makes that sine graph on the left a higher and higher frequency. It therefore makes the Laplace transform integrand function a higher and higher frequency, and it makes these areas tend to cancel each other out more. For example, this area and this area are very close in value. They effectively cancel each other out. Ultimately, the Laplace transform outputs are smaller. That makes sense because when omega is bigger, the bottom of this fraction is bigger. That makes the output smaller. And now we try to finally analyze why the Laplace transform function here is not always decreasing. Let's go back to setting omega to be 0.77 again, and now let's think about what happens as s increases. As s increases, this exponential decay purple graph will decrease faster and faster. That's making the Laplace transform integrand function decay faster and faster, though still with oscillation, so we still have positive and negative contributions to the integral. However, because of the exponential decay, this positive signed area is overwhelming any other negative signed areas that come through from the oscillation. Therefore, the Laplace transform is increasing toward a maximum value here near s equals 0.54 and near a signed area of 0.61. As I continue increasing s further and further, the exponential decay gets even more extreme, and this still dominates. However, its area gets smaller and smaller, now making the Laplace transform function decrease after a certain point. So yes, in summary, when your little f of t function oscillates above and below the axis, your capital F of S function doesn't have to always be decreasing. If you're new to my channel, be sure to subscribe. I have hundreds of videos, in fact, it's even close to 1,000 right now, on many topics in university mathematics, including on real analysis, complex analysis, abstract algebra, differential equations of linear algebra, and financial mathematics for actuarial science. Thanks for watching.